And the last principle is the principle of the sustainable quantitative changes as the outcome of the experiment. Not something new, not change. No, of course, it's different. You have to prove that as a result of your experimental study, the changes the child has are sustainable, can preserve for long time. They are not temporary. So they are really, because what we need is a qualitative change. If the results disappear in 2 days, what's that? Okay, you are doing something, you are doing intervention, you get the result, you see the statistical differences, and then you have a measurement in 2 weeks, and there is no result anymore. There were just temporary results. Wow, what a shame. No, impossible.
Why is it impossible?
No, for Vygotsky it's impossible. If you have such kind of result, it is not Vygotskyan approach, because for Vygotsky's method, the results should be sustainable, because the results are indicators of the quantitative change which cannot kind of be returned to the previous stage as level. Yeah?
Okay, but is it that the reason why I'm struggling here is because...
Are you struggling? No, you're just...
If you can, you know, you do, something happens, you can see a change. If a few days later you can't see that change, it doesn't actually mean that it's
it does not, of course, if you think about change, but I'm thinking about development of results, which are not just change, as I told in the beginning. Sorry, man. Okay. So. Yeah, they should have been. Look here, and this is a short summary. So, what we mean when we speak out of historical theory, we mean that this is the only one theory which really gives the answer and provides the instruments, theoretical instruments, to analyze the process of development, of cultural development of the human being. And there is a unique theory from this point of view, because this is the only one which gives such a number of instruments. There is no other theory which has such a great number of instruments which are really so adjusted to each other that they, using all together, they really bring a possibility to reconstruct, to restore the process of development theoretically and experimentally. And that's why, well, this is the big challenge for the 21st century. If somebody from you is really interested in working in development of psychology, you have no other way just to learn and study cultural historical theory, because this now is the most interesting approach which really has good instruments to understand the developmental nature of a human being, because human being is the being which can develop himself or herself. Animals cannot formulate for themselves their task to be developed. Animals, horse, will be horse forever. But human being can be human being, or can be a horse, or pig, or whatever as well. But how to develop yourself as a human being? This is the theory which explains this process. Thank you very much for your attention. You don't have a phone call? We have time for questions. How much?
Half an hour.
But please, before this half an hour, I can't ask you. Give me 3 minutes to go out for one cancer seat. Oh, it's great. Okay, you can go. Please, well. Drama. For him, development is dramatical. Dramatical process, because his background was literature, theater, philosophy, and he really completely understood that if we had no concept of drama, we would never be able to understand the human development this is always a dramatic process, coming through the dramatic events in your life, which really will change your personality. If you have no dramatic events in your life, so you are remain undeveloped personally. I mean, it changes your sensitivity, it changes your understanding of other people, it teaches you how to subdivide, how to differ together. Oh, yeah, he had very dramatic life. If you just look on the internet, description of his life, he was very full of dramatic events. He died very young, at the age of 27, and he was gravely ill by tuberculosis, and he had to go to the hospital every two, three years, but there was not any syringes at the time, and it was a pneumonia track, a very painful procedure, and he was very close to death many, many times in his life. And then his, the situation in Soviet Union was awful. Civil war, then those years, and then the beginning of the Stalin's gulag, and his friends were arrested, Mandelstam was arrested, and well, this is what, his life was also very, very, very dramatic. And maybe it was a major impact to the writings as well. It was one of the most dramatic lives in the history of psychology.
If I'm allowed to comment, this is very important because it could contrast Piaget and Vygotsky. Piaget lived in a very stabilized society that
a very long
was working as a clock. And Vygotsky participated in a revolution. So he was also very active in trying to find new ways of dealing with existing societal problems. So it was very
effective. And by the way, Piaget and Vygotsky, they both were born the same year, 1896. In the same year, but very short life of Vygotsky, very long life of their lives were very different. Yeah. You can ask anything.
Louder.
Yeah.
Louder.
Microphone. Maybe you can use microphone. Just a moment. Because this is my beloved student. Because this is always a student who bring my book here. I signed the book here. That's for her. That's why I got her. And she's the only one who can name the list. She's the only one who can name the list of the workshop. And
I want to ask you about what do you mean by dramatic collision between two people? How do we understand these two people? Do they have to be two living people face to face like this, or can I read your book and I get a dramatic collision with it? And it is also like a communication between two persons.
It's very general, because look, it's a general law of development. So it is not a special. So it puts a general idea of dramatic collision as a necessary step through which we should pass in development. It might be the event of personal communication between two friends. It might be an event when you see the movie and it was so great impact for me because I associated this one of the heroes of the movie and then any kind of collision which brings changes to me, which I analyze, and then I say to myself, Nikolai, you were so bad yesterday, please never do this again. What does it is a thinking, yeah? Mm-hmm. Then I remember what I did. I said, Nikolai, never forget about that mistake. So my memory is working, yeah? And then I say to myself, I should promise to myself not to do this again. So this is the real one. So all the processes are involved in this Pirishvaniya. So the Pirishvaniya is not a combination just of emotions and intellect. No, all processes, memory is here, and will is here, and thinking is here, and emotions and everything. This is the one. It's very general. The types of this category, the types of events might be different. And what Milda is doing, for example, she is creating the story, fairy tale, and the child identifies himself some of the heroes who had a collision, and the child experiences this collision as if this collision happens with him. So this is the way, one of the ways, because, well, we cannot wait until the child really have a collision in his life. We can create this collision, or just we can use the sum and direct methods for this. Yeah? But, well, the general approach should be that there is no experiment without the automatical event in the beginning. Because every function appears twice. First as this collision, and second then inside the child. If it does not appear first time, it will never appear second time.
Does Vygotsky say anything about how to create dramatic events? I mean, I'm thinking of schooling.
Yeah.
And in school you want, well, in this way of thinking, you want to create these dramatic events so students will learn.
I see your point. You remember we had a lecture about Davidov the week. Victor was speaking to you. But one of these things is Davidov, he was speaking about learning tasks. Yeah? Learning tasks. If you look on Davidov's, you see that every learning task arises as a problem. As a problem for the kids. And you remember that they said that this is a problem. The other class erased some fragments from the formula, and they cannot find the solution. We might help them. So it's again a sort of collision. Yeah, it's not emotional, but more intellectual. Yeah, the problem which we have to solve. It's one of the ways of creating this collision. Might be intellectual collision.
Yeah, don't you think there always should be also an emotional element?
Yeah, I think that it should be. My understanding is it should be. It should not be only intellectual. Because of course there are kids who really love to solve intellectual tasks.
Yes,
but there are kids who don't. And there are kids who would love to help somebody to find a solution. So. And it's also okay because they are as well involved in the search of the right solution. But those kids are trying to find a solution because of intellectual task, and those kids are trying to find a solution because they want to help somebody. So, but it doesn't matter from psychological point of view. What matters is that they are experiencing this as a collision, as their own personal involvement. Yeah. See.
When children interact, a lot of children interact together, and they are different processes. So it's not just, for example, language. And how I would say emotionally, or deep or sign. So the all three forms they do in develop in different ways. So how you will recommend to analyze this kind of?
Wow, that's a very deep question, by the way. But what I wanted to present today was just some general, very general and very methodological and very theoretical concepts. Of course, every concept should be specified, should be applied to some concrete situation of the, well, of the age and the educational settings and the individual work, the group work. So, but my task was then to show that there are some general frame and principles which should be somehow presented in the research. And of course the research might be different, but it should be created in maximum way according to those. Because life of course is richer. And what I was describing is the ideal experiment. Like in physics. In physics there is the idea of ideal experiment. The experiment in vacuum, for example. But there is no vacuum. So they're using the idea of ideal experiment to design the real experiment. So it's again interesting to the real form, by the way. So my picture for today was just to show to you that the ideal experiment is new approach. So my task was to show the difference between traditional development of psychology, classical, and genetical development of psychology introduced by Vygotsky as an alternative, as a methodological alternative to those theories of development which are still in the state of crisis for the last 80 years. And your task is to try to find a way how to apply those general requirements to your concrete research program. And it will help you to shape, to design, to conduct your concrete research in more logical way according to Vygotsky's theory. That was my main message. Well, sorry, it was very bad answer to your great question, but when we can maybe later discuss your complete research, and then we will find the way how to do it. Because, well, I can give you the general thing today. All the complete things are in the face-to-face dramatical collision. Yeah, welcome.
Qualitative organization of psychological system, what should be the aspects that we do not forget when we do the analysis?
That's a question, because if you look again on Vygotsky, you see that he never used the statistics.
Never.
In no book he's analyzing the huge statistic and variables and statistically valid changes. No. He, lot of experiments he did just using case studies, especially with his daughters, by the way. Yeah, with his daughters. And Gita, his daughter Gita Wagner, who is still alive and celebrating this year his 80th birthday, still remembers that the father was doing experiments, giving them some tasks and plays and questions and stuff. But for him, it was absolutely clear that very often statistical changes say nothing. Very often, it's much more important to the historic process of development just having 1, 2, 3 case studies to see. And if it's able to repeat the same process, the same instruments on the other edge, so it means that probably in real life development goes according to these stages as well. So, and this is again a new type of experiment, which is more or less free from statistical calculations. But how to measure? This is the problem of the problem. And I have no answers yet for this, but I'm also continuing my work on it, and we have a plan to write a book, develop genetic research methodology, main principles and requirements from Vygotsky, and maybe in this book we will make it some more detailed. But what I told you is just what I'm working on now. So you presented your results. Your intermediate results, what you are doing now. I'm presenting the same what I'm doing now, so I have no final answers to the questions, but you see that at least you see my directions.
Yes, I ask that because I think it's very easy to confuse the qualitative analysis with quantitative analysis.
Yeah. So we should think together about it, how which methods we should be used to prove that our changes or the results are really qualitative change. So it may require some new methods of scaling or something. Well, but as I told, well, I was in the process of continuing this thing, this my own project. And then I of course, if somebody is interested, you can join, we can discuss, and maybe write a book together.
I'm trying to get a handle on you talk about this qualitative change. So a child gains a new understanding of something. Is that, you know, like?
Not completely, but because new understanding is, well, like a new type of thinking or something like this. But because he said that we should somehow detect the how the other processes change.
How the other processes?
How the processes changes during the yeah. Because she says that the reorganization means that there are no processes which remain the same as the result. So they all are changing. So it should be some complex analysis. But I have no clear idea yet about, but I'm sure that this is the way we should do, because, well, there's no alternative for my group.
The reason the idea I'm grappling with here is this that you may see a child undertake something or understand a concept or use a concept one day. 2 weeks later,
because there were just temporary changes, and then.
I'm thinking specifically of.
So those changes were not qualitative changes, but qualitative change means that there's no way back.
There's no way back, okay.
Yeah? Because if you have a network, there's no way back to the flower. Yeah? Flower is over.
I guess that there's that. I was talking before with Alice about the idea that the change. Whether a change has occurred is different to whether the child can show you that the change has occurred.
Yeah, I see what you say. I understand.
Because I'm thinking specifically of children with autism, and one day they seem to be able to do a particular activity or they understand something, and the next day it's as if someone's pulled the plug.
Yeah, right. Maybe in this case it might be useful to apply some supporting subgroup, sub-experimental things which can support for some time this process of obtaining a microbiology or something. Well,
we have only one question, and I think it's very long time to
Andrea, well...
I can try without...
I'll
try to speak up.
Good!
You were talking about child development. Is it possible that this is like, does this apply to microgenesis as well, what you said? Is this Vygotskian or not?
Yeah. So, I was speaking about child development, that's right, but actually I was just telling you what Vygotsky was speaking about child development, yeah? I was working in a radio station, just broadcasting the written text, yeah? Well, but... there is one point which is very important. If you look on Vygotsky's article, which is called The Problem of Age, I forgot the which one, but there is a big fragment in one of the papers of Vygotsky, of three pages, where he describes the difference between phenomenological experiment and genetical experiment, and said that genetical experiment does not exclude the phenomenological. The short descriptive empirical thinking. Well, this micro should be somehow incorporated into the genetical experiment as a necessary part, describing maybe some stable periods or something like that, with the purpose to be supplementary, to be additional. Because, of course, genesis is a long process, and we can divide into microgenetical periods. But anyway, if you are using only microgenetical things, we will never cover the whole. So, you understand what I mean, yeah?
Yeah, I'm thinking especially...
So we have to find a combination between the general method and those methods of microgenesis, which can work together, make more detailed analysis of different stages and maybe aspects of this.
So you can never study adults?
No, Vygotsky was mostly doing experiments with the kids, but as you know, Luria was making experimentation in Middle Asia, Uzbekistan, and Luria was making experiments exclusively with adults. And the results are published and they were known. You know, I can give you the link. So it means that and Luria was mostly working with adults as a neuropsychologist as well. But Vygotsky was mostly working with the kids because of his profession and specialization. Yeah.
So can you use this with absolutely?
Yeah, I think yeah, because well, development doesn't stop. Human being is the only being who develops on the whole life, and that's good. So it means that well, I think that if we not stop to have our cultural development, then we can apply the general genetic law to every age. If somebody stops his development, general genetic law never works. Yeah, and then there's the final draw. 1.5 cents. Thank you very much and forgive my